talking about the important problem of scattering of electromagnetic waves. So we're looking at a situation where we have some incident field which scatters off some scattered center. And this could be a molecule, it could be an electron. It's something that's, we're looking at the moment, a very small scattering center whose size is tiny compared to the wavelength that we're scattering off. Okay? So generally speaking, we define the differential scattering cross-section as the ratio of the differential electromagnetic power that is scattered into some direction divided by the incident flux of energy or the intensity. And so expressing that power in terms of the pointing vector and the same for the intensity of the incident field, then the differential scattering cross-section can be expressed in terms of this ratio times the distance r squared from the scattering center taken at the origin of that scatterer. Okay? And when our scattering center, our scatterer, is very well localized, then the dominant radiation that is scattered is electric dipole radiation. That's what we've been studying, the multiple expansion. And unless for some reason the induced dipole moment vanishes for some symmetry reasons, the dominant effect is electric dipole. And we know, far from the source, the nature of the scattered field. It's a spherical wave with a vector amplitude that depends on the strength of the induced dipole moment, but there's a vector dependence on that because the scattered electric field must be transverse to the direction of propagation. Okay? So when we plug that in, we ended up with a differential scattering cross-section, which generally depends on polarization. I should say, when we wrote this out, what we ended up with, if we had the induced dipole moment, if we just wrote that as proportional to the incident field, okay, so this is what we'll put more formally as the first Born approximation. Then we had an expression for this. Just plugging into that, we get k to the 4th alpha squared. The perpendicular component of this. Well, it just depends on the perpendicular component of the incident polarization. Which we said was 1 if we had so-called sigma polarization and was equal to cosine theta squared if we had so-called pi polarization. Right? That is, if our polarization was in the plane of incidence, we called it pi. If it was perpendicular to incidents, we call it sigma.
So, can you explain why
they're named pi and sigma? Yeah, they're named pi and sigma because those are the Greek letters for P and S, which are the German, well, the German word for parallel is parallel, and the German word for perpendicular starts with an S. It's strange call something, but, you know, they were the physicists at the time, but yeah.
So, if P remember, like, way back freshman year in a chemistry course, like, something with molecular orbitals or something, and they also had pi and sigma.
Right.
But is that, is there any relation, or is that just...
It's the same notion of the, of, they're also about parallel and perpendicular, but they have nothing to do with polarization. They're named exactly that for that same reason.
Okay.
Also, you may know in atomic spectroscopy, or even in molecular, if you talk about spectroscopy and you have a quantization axis and the polarization of the light is parallel to the polarization, to the quantization axis, we call it pi polarization. And if it's perpendicular to the quantization axis, we call it sigma polarization. Sigma plus, sigma minus, that's where those come from. All right. So, excuse me. Right, so we looked at some important examples. If we looked at the total scatter and cross section, integrating over all directions, assuming that the incident light was unpolarized and we're collecting all polarizations of the scattered light, then there were two cases we looked at, so-called Thomson scattering, which is the scattering of essentially free electrons, scattering of electromagnetic waves off of electrons that are essentially free, which is equivalent to saying if they're bound, that the frequency is much, much, much bigger than the binding energy frequency. And we found in that case that the polarizability goes like 1 over the frequency squared, so it canceled the frequency dependence on k, and we got a constant. And that constant is the Thomson scattering cross-section, as long as the energy of the photon is small compared to the rest mass of the electron. When we start getting to that high of energy, then we have to worry about Compton scattering. But in this regime, in between that, we have the problems of scattering. Very important is the notion of Rayleigh scattering, where we're looking at the scattering off of bound electrons, where we're looking at frequencies that are small compared to the binding energy, in which case, the polarizability is essentially constant, in which case the scattering cross-section has an extremely strong frequency dependence. And the Rayleigh scattering cross-section scales like the fourth power of the frequency, as long as that frequency is small compared to omega naught. Okay? And we discuss why the sky is blue, and some of you did some experiments and saw, yeah, indeed, the sky is blue. But it's white when you look at the sun. Okay. Now, one of the things we discussed at the end of lecture was the notion of attenuation by scattering, where instead of just thinking about one tiny scattering center, one scatterer. We had some assumed collection, like a gas, for example, or it could be a liquid, and we're coarse graining over different chunks of that liquid or solid, what have you. And we said, okay, well, this light comes in and is scattered in all different directions. And so there's an incident intensity, and there's a, say, an output intensity at, say, some distance z along the direction of propagation. And the way what we found was that the rate at which the intensity changes as a function of propagation through this gas was given by the delicious Beer-Baer's law, which said that this was equal to minus n being the density of scatterers times the scattering cross-section per scatterer times I. Okay? So that the scattering leads to an exponential decay of the intensity, and if the total length of the sample is L, then the intensity right at the output was equal to e to the minus the optical density, where the OD is equal to N sigma times L. Okay? Now, the way in which we obtained this law was to basically say, well, we know what the power scattered by each scattering center is. And so in a particular slice, the amount of power that is transmitted through that slice was the incident power minus the amount of power that's scattered out. And we just said the total power scattered out was the sum of the powers that were scattered from each scattering center. But wait a minute. We're not supposed to add intensities. These are waves. We're supposed to add fields and then square to get the power. So how in the world did we get away with that? Should we have gotten away with that? Shouldn't we think about the following picture? Here's all my scattering centers. Okay. And the wave is coming in. It's supposed to have equal wavelengths. Some of these scattering centers are near the peak of the wave, and some of these scattering centers are near the trough of the wave. So the induced dipole moment in this approximation, well, it will have a different phase of oscillation depending upon whether it's at the peak or the trough, right? We're driving a dipole, and some of these dipoles are at the peak of the oscillation, some are at the trough. And then these emit some wave into, and we're looking now, my beautiful eyeball out there, and we should look at the interference between these scattered amplitudes. And in addition to the fact that these two antennae are oscillating with different phases, the path difference to me is different from these two different scattering centers generally. And so the phase accumulated on its way to me will be different. So I have to think about the interference. Between amplitudes radiated or scattered from different points. Okay. So, let's look at the electric field associated with the scattered wave, associated with one of the scattering centers. A scatterer. So the induced dipole moment is equal to alpha times the incident field at the position of the scatterer. Okay? Let's take the incident field as a function of position as E0 e to the ik incident dot x. Okay, say as a function of position of the scatterer. So this is the phase of the oscillation at the position of the scatterer. Sometimes it could be at the peak, sometimes it could be at the trough. So now the scattered wave at the position of observation is equal to omega over c squared times the p induced, the perpendicular component thereof, times e to the ik. Now this particular scatterer is not centered at the origin, it's centered at position x prime. So it's a spherical wave emanating from x prime. Now, if we're far away, in the far field, then as we've approximated many times now, this is approximately equal to e to the ik r over r times e to the minus ik r hat dot x prime, making the expansion of x minus x prime as we have done many times. And so what we see here is what we have, the wave front seen by me is a spherical wave that's phase shifted by an amount that depends on where the scatterer is relative to the origin. Okay, so this is the additional phase shift. So this we typically write as e to the minus has a scattering wave vector, which is radially outward. And this is the additional phase accumulated relative to the origin. So now we can put all of this together, and we see that the scattered electric field amplitude, complex amplitude, I guess I forgot the polarized, oh no, it's, right, so now I've got to plug in this over here. So that's equal to k squared alpha E0 perp e to the minus I k scattered minus k in dot x prime e to the I k r over r. Okay, so what we see here for a particular scatterer that's not at the origin, the electric field amplitude that's associated with that scattered wave has an additional phase shift depending upon where the scatterer is relative to the origin, and depending on this difference between the scattered wave vector and the incident wave vector, which we typically call Q. Now, one thing to notice if you have big enough chalk, you can notice it, is that if we consider so-called forward scattering, which is to say, suppose we are looking as the scattered wave, all the scattered waves that are scattered into the same direction, as the incident wave, okay? So let's consider that case. So forward scattering means that the incident wave vector is equal to the scattered wave vector, or vice versa. In that case, the scattered electric field amplitude is independent of the position of the scatterer. Why is that? Well, the math tells you that, but what's going on? I mean, what's going on is that if, let's just look at this in 1D, all right, because it's only the phase along this direction. But atoms that are, say, or atoms or scatterers that are closer to the input phase, see less phase accumulated than the, from the incident wave than the atoms that are at the near the output phase. But that's completely compensated by the fact that this wave has to propagate in that direction by exactly the same amount that this one is closer by. So no matter where they are, it subtracts off. You see the difference. There's two different phase shifts. There's a plus and a minus. So for the forward direction, everything is always at the same phase.
But how come Ks and Ki has the same value?
Oh, that's a good point. So the magnitude we are assuming here this is so-called elastic scattering. Okay, I should have emphasized that, it's a good point. We're assuming here that the electromagnetic waves that are scattered at the same frequency as the incident wave, okay? That will be the case for our Lorentz oscillator model. When we are, you know, in steady state, we know that the oscillator oscillates at the frequency of the drive. You can have other kinds of scattering whereby you end up transferring some of the frequency into other degrees of freedom. They're so-called Raman scattering, for example, where you might, in a molecule, you transfer some of the energy into a rotation of a molecule, and then the frequency might be less. Stokes and anti-Stokes and all kinds of stuff you can have. At the moment, and for the remainder, we're focusing on elastic scattering. Okay. So if the directions are the same, then the wave vectors are the same. All right, we'll come back to this fact in a moment. It's an important fact. It tells us something about now what happens when we look at the interference term. So now consider a collection of discrete scatterers. Just start. okay, like that picture over there. So now the total scattered field into a particular direction, given a certain input direction, is equal to the sum of these summed over the different positions. So the sum over I scatterers, I equals 1 to some number n scatterers, k squared, alpha E zero perp e to the minus iq, not the ith position of the scatterer, e to the ik dot for k r over r. Okay, just summing over all those amplitudes, which of course the only thing that depends on the position of the scatterer is this additional phase. So we have the factor that we had before can be taken outside of the sum and we have this additional sum over here. So let's consider this factor. Suppose we coarse grain to a macroscopic dielectric so that I can turn the sum over the discrete positions of my scatterers into an integral over a continuum of scatterers with n being the density of scatterers. Okay, so I just turned my sum into a integral where this is the small, this d cubed x times n is the number inside a little volume. Okay? All right. Well, we see right away then that this factor is nothing else than the spatial Fourier transform of the density. Right? With some 2 pi's maybe, but we'll forget about that. Evaluated at q, where q is the difference between the scattered wave vector versus the spatial Fourier transform. So the scattered field that we see from this collection of scatterers is nothing more than being proportional to the Fourier transform of the spatial distribution of scatterers, a fact well known to people who study optics. So let's suppose that we had, instead of something like a gas, suppose I have water, something very smooth on the scale of the wavelength. So suppose I consider I have a uniform density. Some n naught inside the sample. Well, then, this Fourier transform is equal to that integral, which is like a delta function. I mean, it's assuming this were infinitely big expanse of water. I mean, it would otherwise it would, you know, be like a sink function or something like that, depending on how wide the sample was. But let's ignore that for the moment to emphasize an important point here. What is this telling me? It's telling me that the scattered field, under the assumption that I had an infinite volume, that the scattered electric field amplitude equals zero if Q doesn't equal zero. That is to say, if the scattered wave vector does not equal to the incident wave vector. That is to say, if I have this very smooth dielectric and I put my field inside of it, there's no diffuse scattering. All of the, if there is any scattering, it's only into the forward direction. No diffuse scattering. Yes?
So physically speaking, would that be a result of other scatters canceling out the scattered wavelengths?
Well, yes, canceling out is the right word. What we have, at the end of the day, this is an interference effect. We're summing the phasors associated with the position of the scattering sectors and this wave vector, which is the difference between the incident and scattered wave vector. And the only place that you have constructive interference is in the forward direction. In all other directions, you have complete destructive interference. That's what this sum says, which becomes an integral. So the moral of the story, boys and girls, is that diffuse scattering arises solely from fluctuations in the density. So, say it another way, if I write the density as a, well, okay, come back to that more. So if I write the density as some mean value plus some variation as a function of x, then the Fourier transform of this, which I have up here, you can see it, has that forward peak plus the Fourier transform of the fluctuation. And so if I see scattering into a direction k other than the incident direction, it is due to a variation in the density as a function of position. If the density were uniform, then there can be no scattering other than into the forward direction. Alrighty. So, we can formalize this a little bit more. Yes?
Wait, but if we consider a finite space, it also has some.
So that is, so okay, so indeed, let's suppose that I have some finite collection of scatterers with some density fluctuation. What would I see in this case? Well, this would not be an infinite volume, it would be a finite volume. So instead of having something which is zero except at the right at q equals zero, there will be some spread in q around q equals zero, whose spread is inversely related, according to the Fourier theorem, to the width in real space. So what I will see in this case is the scattered field, there will be some cone of forward scattering whose diffraction angle here is inversely related to this width. The bigger this width is, the narrower this cone is. So it becomes, as the width becomes infinity, this gets narrower and narrower and narrower. That's Fourier theorem. And then in addition, we'll have some diffuse scattering that comes from the density fluctuations. So there's what you might call the coherent forward cone and the diffuse scatter. Yeah?
Is the physics that's employed in the current scanners not used by the TSA?
I'd have to kill you if I told you. No, I have no idea. I really have no clue.
Because you could reconstruct whatever.
Oh yeah.
The density is,
sure, sure. Yes, indeed. I mean, no. But image reconstruction is just this, right? I mean, look at the Fourier. If you look at the Fourier decomposition of scattered fields or intensities, then you can inverse Fourier transfer it to get the density distribution. So, let's formalize this a little bit more. So now what we know is that the scattered intensity is proportional to the square of this interference term. Okay? Which is equal to that sum. So if the positions of the scatterers are not exactly known, for example, in a gas in room temperature, we would typically average this over some probability distribution associated with where the positions are. So we average this over a probability distribution. This is known as the structure factor. Okay. Sometimes this is normalized by n, 1 over n. I'll just write it like this for now. So you notice we can write this, oh, we can break up the sum over the cases where I equals j and the cases where I is different from j. The cases from I different from j correspond to interference between different scattering centers. The cases where I equals j is the intensity arising from a particular scattering center. Okay? So this structure factor as written is equal to, I'll just write it out just to reemphasize the facts. Contribution from, this is sometimes known as the incoherent contribution, because it just corresponds to adding the intensity associated with each scattering center, independent of interference, which is about coherence. And this is the interference term, and of course I need to average this over the ensemble. Yes.
So it seems like with this, like you kind of assume that you have all, like all of your scatterers are the same type.
Yes.
But can you still do the same thing if you have multiple kinds of scatterers that are mixed in?
Sure. I mean, you'd have to think about this a little bit in terms of this expression here, which assumed a single polarizability.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, we'd have to, in some sense, you know, normalize this in some way relative to the different strengths of the polarizability for different scatterers.
Okay.
But I'm most familiar with this in the context, I mean, this is true for wave scattering of any kind, this form of relation. This is not just about electromagnetic scattering. And this kind of description with this important structure factor is used all the time, for example, in, say, neutron scattering off of semiconductors, right? And you would then try to look at the structure of your semiconductor by looking at where the peaks are of the scattered neutrons. And that's and in that case, again, it's typically you're assuming that your scattering center is some crystal. Now, whether how you would formulate that when you had multiple different kinds of scatterers, it seems like it's certainly, the mathematics is there. It's just not something I've seen.
Okay.
So this interference term, let's talk again about this a little bit more. If we have a uniform density, then this, again, this all of these terms will destructively interfere, zero for q not equal to zero. But for q equals zero, this is equal to n times n minus one. Let me write this in a, other than in the corner of the board. So this, I claim, is zero if q is not equal to zero, if I have a uniform infinite extent, density, and it's equal to n times n minus 1 if q equals 0. So for a uniform density, the structure factor is equal to n squared times the delta function for q equals 0. Which means, going back to this picture over here, the amount of intensity that's forward scattered into this coherent cone is proportional to the square of the number of scatterers, because that's an interference effect. And interference, the field's proportional to n, but the power is proportional to the square of the field. So it's proportional to n squared. Okay? If I have, suppose I have a random distribution of point scatterers, well then, this thing, when I doesn't equal j, no matter what q is, this is zero for all q. Because if I have a random, if I go back to this picture, or this random bunch of scatterers, I'm looking over here, there is going to be a completely random phase between all of these waves. Which means that there is, on average, for a large collection of scatterers, there is no interference, neither constructive nor destructive. Which means that the fields that I see in that direction are just the incoherent sum of the fields associated with each individual scatterer. And in that case, my scattering is just equal to, well, this is not actually, the structure factor itself is, doesn't have a delta function. This is, because it's just a sum. There's no integral here. Sorry. For q equals 0. For all q. So, this is why we were able to get away with Beer's law. Beer's law assumed that we could just add the power that was scattered incoherently from each scattering center. That is a fine and good approximation when we have a fairly random set of scatterers. For example, if I have an atomic vapor and I shine a laser beam through it, the amount of attenuation that I'll see on that laser beam will be determined by Beer's law or sunlight through the atmosphere. But if I'm looking at light propagating through a very smooth distribution, well then I will see almost no attenuation. Other than, of course, reflection at the boundary, that's a big fluctuation in the intensity. It goes from nothing to a lot. And it's there that I'm going to see end of the scattering right at the interface, but after that, almost nothing. All right? Okay, so we cheated, but we got the right answer. Let's see. Oh, yeah. Let's continue over there. So even if I have a random distribution of scatterers, or I have a large fluctuation in the density of these material that's doing the scattering, we still have, regardless of uniform or not, we always have forward scattering. That's what we said. There's always forward scattering that is coherent. What is the physical implication of forward scattering? So, you know, here's again my collection of scatterers. I'm gonna, you know, I have some very large extent plane wave coming in. And we know that there's gonna be some forward scatter, which eventually becomes plane light in the forward direction. Okay? And furthermore, we said that all of these guys have the same phase so that they all add up coherently. What is the effect of this forward scattering? Well, the forward scattered wave interferes with the incident wave. So, although I drew this in a certain way, that's probably a misleading picture. What I really should draw is something that looks like this. In other words, this scattered wave need not be in phase or out of phase with the incident wave. The phase accumulated depended upon the density of scatterers and the strength of the scattering. What this means is that what you'll end up is phase shifting the total field.
Bless you.
Incident plus forward scattered is phase shifted. And that phase shift is nothing more than the index of refraction. In other words, why does light travel at a different, not at the speed of light in the medium? Well, of course it travels at that speed of light. Light travels at the speed of light. What we call the speed of the wave is the speed, say the phase velocity, for example, is looking at the time delay of, say, some peak of the wave. But that peak can come to me at a later time because, well, some of that wave gets absorbed, it gets re-radiated, that takes some time. And then that next, so it's because of that delay in the time of re-emission, the interference of the re-radiated wave with the incident wave delays the arrival of the peak at my position, which makes me feel like the wave is traveling slowly. So light travels at the speed of light. It's just that our effect, the effect of the interference of the re-radiated waves with the incident wave has the effect of delaying the arrival of a peak or a trough, which is the index of refraction. All right, now, there's a little paradox to think about. just to reiterate, the interference of the incident wave with the forward scattered wave index of refraction. All right, however, we can take a look at the phase of that wave. So consider the following thing. Suppose I have e to the I n as a function of omega over c. That's the phase associated with the wave propagating in this material that has some index. And suppose we say, so n of omega is the square root of epsilon of omega is equal to the square root of 1 plus 4 pi, the density of scatterers, alpha of omega, right? Which is approximately equal to, say, 1 plus 2 pi for the valued sample. So let's look at this. Let's say that we look at the propagation for a very small delta z, so that this is equal to 1 plus I n of omega delta z. So this is sort of the incident wave, and this is the contribution Let's write it out. We have 1 plus I 2 pi plus I n of omega, which is 1 plus 2 pi n alpha. So this is equal to 1 plus I omega over c delta z plus 2 pi n alpha. So to lowest order, what's the point? Well, this is approximately e to the I omega over c delta z. This is the phase in the absence of material. And this is the additional phase shift coming from alpha. Now, we expect, I should have this in I. That when alpha is real, that gives rise to the real part of the index of refraction, which gives rise to the phase shift. But when alpha is imaginary, that can give rise to either attenuation or amplification. Right? But if I look at this wave, let's see, did I erase it? I guess I did. Let's look at it over here. So let's say we look at this with Q equals zero. Suppose alpha is real. Well, this looks like, if I, you know, look in the far field here, that this wave will either add in amplitude or subtract in amplitude, which would lead to either gain or attenuation when alpha is real. And if alpha is imaginary, it looks like the phase, you know, the phaser, so I have a phaser. This is my phaser for my E incident. And then I have my scattered field, which is either, looks like it's adding, if alpha is greater than zero, it looks like it gives me amplification. If alpha is less than zero, it looks like I get attenuation. And if I'm, when alpha is imaginary, it looks like I add a phaser that's, well, phase shift the phaser. It looks like I'm getting the reverse effect than what I expected. It looks like this phase is adding in amplitude and adding when alpha is real, and adding in quadrature when alpha is imaginary. That's exactly the opposite of what we expect. We expect the real alpha to give rise to the real part of the index of fraction, and the imaginary part of alpha to give rise to the imaginary part, the absorption or amplification. So what the heck is going on? Yeah, anyone have an idea? Yeah.
Alpha's imaginary, doesn't that mean that you're close to resonance, so you're getting radiated in that direction?
It is true that you're going to get some, the imaginary part of alpha is going to be associated, typically, if we're talking about scattering, with scattering in other directions. But that scattering in other directions should come from taking the energy out of the incident wave. So it better be the case, assuming the imaginary part is positive, that leads to attenuation. This is a very subtle and tricky point. The point here is that we describe the incident wave as a plane wave. Okay, so if I go back to this board, this picture is a plane wave. Look at this as a plane wave. And we assume we got far enough away that we can get far enough away from this plane that we're in the far field. It's impossible for us to get infinitely far from an infinite plane. To do that, we really, if we were to really treat it with plane waves, we really should treat the whole system as infinitely transverse, and then look at not the Green's function in 3D, but the Green's function in 1D. In which case you will find that the radiated field has a factor of I associated with that. The Green's function has another I, which turns real into imaginary, imaginary into real. You'll have a problem like that for homework. But suppose you wanted to do this problem for real without infinite plane waves. What we could do is something slightly different. And assume we have a paraaxial laser beam. Remember that from that homework assignment? Where we had the Gaussian beam. Now, right at the waist of the beam, I have something that looks like a plane wave, but it falls off. And I start oscillating this field, and an oscillating field generates a radiated wave, which ultimately interferes with the forward with the laser beam as a forward scattered beam. However, if you go back into your homework and you ask, what is the phase of this spherical wavefront relative to the phase at the center of the laser beam? There was that phase that was like the arctangent of some z over z naught or z naught over z, something like that, something we call the GUI phase. Something like that. If you go back into your notes, when z goes to infinity, this goes to pi over 2. So the phase of the wavefront here is phase shifted by pi over 2 over this compared to the overall propagation distance. In which case, the real alpha adds in quadrature, gives rise to the index of refraction, and the imaginary alpha adds in amplitude, gives rise to attenuation. And it's the GUI phase that's key to getting that right. It's a lot more detail than you probably want to know, but the key I think that's important for you to come away with, and we'll have some experience and homework understanding, because I think it's pretty neat, is to understand that the index of refraction is no more than an interference effect. It's the interference of the forward scattered wave with incident wave that leads to a difference in phase velocity. So have no problem for that. And homework in 1D. Alright, why don't we call it quits for the day? Anyone want to say one of the questions?